Chairman, and friends. You all recall the scene when the poor man who had palsy, or who was a paralytic, was borne by four of his friends who made a hole through the roof of the house where Jesus was and let him down at the feet of Jesus. And you would think that the first thing that he would ask would be for Jesus to heal his body. But before he got time to ask, any opportunity to ask, Jesus healed his soul. Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. This was too much for the devil. He was sitting in the rafters, watching what Jesus would do, because from the very beginning of Jesus' ministry, he knew that Jesus was out to destroy his kingdom, root and branch, and that he would establish his own kingdom on the ruins of the kingdom of Satan. So Satan inspires the Pharisees to tell Jesus that he blasphemes. You, being a man, can you forgive sins? Only God forgives sins. Who are you, anyway? You see, these Pharisees were very orthodox. They said they were true to Moses, because Moses had said there is one God and one God only. And so Jesus, being a man in this world, could not possibly be God. They learned that from the Greeks. The Jews of Jesus' day, these Pharisees, had learned this from Socrates and Plato and Aristotle, that there can be only one abstract principle, which is impersonal. And it is this God that these Pharisees had taken over as their God and substituted this God for the God of the Old Testament. And in the name of this false God, this taken over God, they said that Jesus blasphemed. Well, it would be true if that were the God, but Jesus said that he and the Father are one, that there is one God. If that is true, but that what Moses said, he had come to fulfill. If they only knew Moses and the prophets, as they pretended to know, then they would understand that they spake of him, that he was the Son of God, and that he had come to fulfill the promises through Moses and the prophets. Well, I hear you say, indeed, this is true, but this is for the church to speak of. And it is for the home to teach the children about Jesus, and that he came to save sinners, that he came to save the whole man, soul as well as body, body as well as soul. Well, I ask your attention to Paul's letters to the Ephesians and to the Colossians, in which Paul speaks of the redemption, the healing, and the restoration of all things. He says that Christ, by his blood, as he says literally in Colossians, has come to restore culture. That is, all things, pantar, all of things must be restored because they have been broken. They are separated from God. There's been a rift in the universe, and it is this rift that Christ has come to heal. You say, well, what has that got to do with education? Education teaches reading, writing, arithmetic, history, maybe philosophy. At any rate, it's culture with which the institutions of learning deal. The church deals with salvation of souls. Well, you see, there is this, what Goethe calls the Geist der Staatsvernunft, the spirit which constantly opposes. And he opposes the work of Christ's restoration of all things, everywhere, throughout the whole world. This is a global conflict in which he has called upon his followers to engage. They must fight as good soldiers of the cross, some here, some there, some in the church, some in the home, but others in the profession of education. The fight between Christ and Satan is justice truly carried on in the field of education as it is in the field of the church? And if you still think that you are involved, really involved, in the struggle between God and Satan for the soul of man in the church and in the home, but you are not engaged in it in the school, then you are deceiving yourself. You are not engaged in it to the fullest extent that you must be engaged in it in the home and in the church, unless you are also engaged in it in the field of culture. We know the methods of Satan. They were exhibited at the beginning of history. When God told Adam and Eve that they must not eat of the forbidden tree, then Satan said, well, now look here. Let's be open-minded about this. Let's be scientific. Let's stand on our hind legs and judge for ourselves. You are a personality, and a personality is free, is autonomous. He must take God's hypothesis and Satan's hypothesis and balance them and compare them and then follow the one that you find is true or is most likely true. Well, now the absurdity of that method is obvious because there was no record yet at Harvard or at Yale or at Chicago or anywhere else on earth about what would happen if one ate of such a tree as that. In the nature of the case, God and God alone knew what would happen. Satan didn't know. He must be a liar since he said what God said was not true. But you see, throughout the course of history, it is the method of Satan to introduce what he calls neutrality, which in reality is opposition to the God who is creator and redeemer of this world, and who alone knows the facts and the relations of the facts and what will come out of the facts if you handle them this way or if you handle them the other way. Well, now this is the method of Satan that he began in paradise and that he followed when Jesus came into this world and to instill into the hearts of the Pharisees this bitter opposition to the work of Christ, the healing work of Christ, the healing of the culture of the human race, which Christ came into the world to perform. Now, would Satan win the battle against God? We know he will not. Paul the Apostle says, now thanks be unto God who always causes us to triumph in Christ and maketh known the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. We want Christian schools, my friends, because we want our children, our young people, to see the victory of Christ over Satan in the culture of this world. We want them to be partners in this as soldiers of the cross. We want them to have a part in the performance of this victory. We want them to break down the works of darkness in culture, as well as in what is narrowly called religion. We know that Jesus, the Son of God and Son of Man, will be the victor at last. And we want the vision of this victory as Christ goes marching through the world to be the vision which our young people see and see with us. I call your attention to the first conflict between Christ and Satan in the early ages of history, the conflict of Noah, the man of God. This was the issue, was it not? It was what is today called the I-it dimension and the I-thou dimension. That was the issue. Noah built an ark. He was told to do so. He was not wiser than were the others of his time. It was not because he had deeper philosophical, metaphysical insight than did his fellows, his contemporaries, but it's because he found grace in the sight of God, and God spoke to him as he had spoken to Adam in paradise. And God told him to build this ark. The children of Seth had failed to build an independent culture. There were among these of the children of Seth that no doubt said, look, in the I-it dimension, the field of science, it matters not if you associate with the children of Cain. It's only in religion, a privat sache, something private, something individual, that you must serve the living God, and you cannot associate with these others. Notice how soon, relatively, there was but one culture in which the difference between the children of Seth and the children of Cain was obliterated. The line of demarcation was effaced. There was now one culture, and it was ready for the judgment of God. And there was no stopping God's wrath when man had failed to obey the cultural mandate which God had given to Adam at the beginning of history. And now then, listen to Noah as he has an argument, a discussion, a dialogue, if you will, with his carpenters, those who helped him build the ark. He was a good employer. He gave them good wages. But at lunchtime, they would sit with him and say, Mr. Noah, what sense does it make to build an ark on the top of a mountain, a ship? Do you expect to ever have this ship go into water? How are you going to get it to the ocean? He says, the ocean will come to the ship. Have you ever seen, some of you who used to travel as I did many years, on the old Lincoln Highway through Pennsylvania, one of those beautiful spots in which there was a ship-like restaurant, and you could go on top of this, and you could see through a telescope. Father first for a nickel, mother second for a nickel. The children after that, each for a nickel. I mean the children first, and then mother, and then father for a nickel. You could see that panoramic vision of beautiful Pennsylvania. Well, now, nobody thought that ship was ever going to sail. I bet it hasn't to this day. I haven't been there for many a year. But Noah said to these carpenters of his, this ship will float right from this spot. Oh, now, Mr. Noah, let's talk sense, shall we? This ship will not float. There have been many rains, as we've had a lot of rain this summer in Philadelphia area here. But there have never been so many rains, and there hasn't been so much flood, that this ship could ever float. History doesn't bear you out. You speak of the God who has spoken to you, who has revealed. That's proof enough that nobody has spoken to you. A God who would sink all of us and drown all of us just can't exist. That kind of God does not exist, cannot exist. You've had a dream, a bad dream. What did you eat, Mr. Noah? Well, don't you see, Noah persisted. He talked about the future on the basis of special redemptive revelation. He said, this ship is built to save culture, to save human culture. All of us who have broken this cultural mandate that our Father was given in paradise and have broken it, we deserve to drown, all of us, and we will. Unless so be you repent, and Moses preached repentance for many years. In patience, God bore with this generation that they might turn unto him. They argued, Moses, Noah, and the carpenters, his friends, his contemporaries, about the future, about the past. He said, because of the past sin of this person named Noah, who represented all mankind, it is that in the realm of science, the I-it dimension, there will be a flood that destroys all men. Now that was the nature of the argument about the future, about the past, and therefore about the present. It's typical of all the arguments that have been carried on throughout all history between the people of God and the people of this world. And now we know, all of us, what happened. The one and only man, Noah, was right. And through him, in the ark, culture, human culture, was saved. And Christ appears. It is the symbol of the saving work of Christ, the ark of salvation, not narrowly of the salvation of each individual human soul, but of human culture. There would be no human culture if there had been no ark in which Noah and his souls had entered. Well, now then, Noah became the one who carried on the first major dialogue with those of his day. The second man we think of in sacred times is Abraham, the friend of God. When he was called out of Ur of the Chaldees, he was called upon to carry on conversation with his neighbors, and he was to tell them that he would inherit that land. It was his, it wasn't theirs. He came as a stranger. He didn't know where he was to go, but this land was to be his and to be the land of his seed forever. And he looked for the city that had foundations, whose builder and maker is God. And now then, the descendants of Abraham were to be like Abraham. They were to be a nation of Abraham, who would be the means by which God would save and bless the nations of the world. That's the promise that God gives to him. Through his seed, the world shall be blessed and culture shall be saved. But how poorly did these descendants of Abraham perform their task? The great majority of them did not visualize their task and did not undertake the performance of it at all. But I call your attention to Daniel as one illustration of a man who did undertake his cultural task, and his three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That's a simple biblical story, and all of us are very familiar with it. You remember that Daniel found favor and love in the sight of the prince of the eunuchs. He was a refined, cultured young man. He and his friends had been taken forcibly from the land of Israel and transported to the land of the Chaldees. And now the king wants these young men of great promise, these youths, these teenagers, he wants them trained in the culture of the Chaldeans. We are told in the culture, in the tongue, and in the manners of the Chaldeans, which means they must forget the manner, the culture of their own past. But they didn't. They were unwilling when their jealous friends, after they had been put over the substance of all the king's dominions, they said to the king, "Now, don't you think you ought to build a great, great altar, a great image here, and have all of us and all men to bow themselves to this image?" They tickled the king's fancy, and they were out, of course, to get Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They knew that these men would eat only pulse. That's an strange expression. It means that they would stick to their culture, which they had learned as a youth. That was an instruction of the theocracy, that they must eat this food and not that food. Whether you like this or not, I don't know what pulse was, maybe oatmeal for all I know. And I like it. But the big point of it is this, that they were sticking to pulse in the face of the instruction that the king had given, that they must forget their measures, their past, and be incorporated in the culture of the Chaldeans. And then the great day of dedication came, and then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refused to bow. And those people that were trying to get them said to the king, "Mr. King, didn't you say that anybody who doesn't bow to your image shall be cast into the furnace of fire. Oh yes, I did. And it's the law of Medes and Persians that can't be broken. And so they were fast bound, we were told, with their hosen and all their clothes and cast into the fire. And the fire was made seven times hotter than usual. The king was so angry at them, he made it so hot that even those who threw them in were burned. And then when the night came and the king could not sleep, his conscience troubling him, he went out to sea and he saw four men, the angel of the covenant, whom they served and would not disobey, and whose name they had refused to give up eating pulse. He saw that they were protected from this fire. When he called them to them and they came out, the smell of fire wasn't upon them. It devoured their enemies. Now then, if you have ever read the beautiful English translation of Ronald Knox, perhaps the best, most beautiful translator of the Bible among Catholics, surely, he speaks of these three young men as they call upon all things in heaven and in earth to praise the Lord for all the winds and the storms and all the powers of earth that be. They must praise the Lord, and they will praise the Lord. And then they confess that they have received what they deserved as a people. The nation of Israel, the theocracy, the people of God, the chosen people, had forsaken to eat pulse. And they were willing to give up their own culture in the interest of progress, in the interest of attaining their purposes. And so now then, they say to God in this their prayer that they are tongue-tied, he says. Tongue-tied we stand that have brought disgrace on the livery of thy true worship. I wish I could write English like that. Tongue-tied we stand, because we, thy people, have brought disgrace upon the livery of thy true worship. We have not stood for our culture. We've not dared to defend it. We have apologized for it. And we have submitted to this tyrant, the greatest tyrant that has appeared in the whole course of history. Only those who have been brought up on pulse can offer such praise to God as this. And only those who have refused to eat anything but pulse can praise such a prayer of agony and of confession of sin. Oh, we would have our Christian school boys and girls with us learn to pray such a prayer as that. A prayer of praise calling upon themselves and calling upon every power in the universe to praise God because he has called upon them that they should do so. And then the prayer of repentance because we have been ashamed of God. And we have in this our day become tongue-tied. We don't dare to speak anymore as we ought to speak. And we don't know what to say in the realm of culture. At best, we say something as preachers and as teachers in our home. Or we may have Christian schools where we have some Bible course. But we have failed to understand what we must speak for our truth. In the field of culture, too. Then when we leave sacred history, we come to the earliest, the greatest philosopher of the whole of the Christian church, namely Saint Augustine. And he it was who spoke of the city of God and the city of man. Each of them have different goals. Suppose you and I want to go to California, as once I did with my family. We traveled along Route 66, the Grapes of Wrath Trail, and we finally landed in California. And it was my blessed experience to pull some oranges for myself off a tree, mind you. Not one of these mishandled and manhandled oranges that we get over here in the East that have been boxcarred and deboxcarred and then mishandled again and manhandled once more. But I actually picked oranges off the tree in Redlands, California. What a wonderful experience. Now that was my goal. Route 66 was my standard. And when I would doubt about it because it would turn to the right or turn to the left, my wife would keep telling me, keep on going, Route 66. They know better than you do on what, how to. Maybe it takes a detour. Maybe you even have to go back east for a little bit in order to get, because there is a bridge out somewhere. Just follow Route 66. If any of you ever have an argument with your wife on such things, follow her advice. Now, then there was the question of motivation. Suppose I have my brand new Pontiac. I didn't then, I do now. And suppose I sit in this new Pontiac and I look very important, and I am in my own eyes very important. I'm going to drive this Pontiac to California, the place where every sensible person wants to go. Well, don't you see, there's no spark, just no spark. And without spark, you don't move. Well, that's the difference between the city of God and the city of man. Man has received those of the city of God. They follow the instructions that God gave to man at the beginning of history, to till the soil, to cultivate the earth, to become a priest, dedicating all things to God, to become a prophet, setting forth the truth about all things under God, and to be a king, subordinating all things under God to God. But Satan seemed to win out. He got man to disobey. He was a prophet without a mantle, a priest without a sacrifice, and a king without a crown. All driven forth from paradise, what a sad mess he has made of history, has he not? Are we not today at the climax of the most miserable situation that has obtained in the whole course of history? Because man has been unwilling to follow that goal, to seek for that goal, and unwilling to follow the route of him who said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I have brought all things back to God through my blood shed on the cross for your sins, for following Satan and his advice instead of being obedient to my voice. Well, now then, these are the three points of which St. Augustine spoke. Two different goals, two different standards, and two different powers of motivation. Man has not the goal that man, those of the city of man have not the goal and not the standard and not the motivation of those that are of the city of God. Now look, my friends, with me for a moment at some of those philosophers of education who are today seeking to set the goal, the standard, and the motivation for education. Dr. Robert Ulich, professor of education at Harvard, speaks of the lack of proper leadership from which American education suffers. The affairs of humanity, he says, are now too complex, quote, to be handled by the simple formulas such as progress and democracy, however well-intended these may be. There is now the cry for a change without any clear direction, a cry for new leadership without a thorough analysis of the requisites which make a good leadership in a specific area of responsibility. He admits that they do not know what the goal is, but he does maintain that if anybody is to set the goal, it must be human society itself that sets the goals and tells the teachers what to teach in order that men, that children may reach this goal. What, says he, do we mean by leadership? We define a leader as a person capable of inspiring other people with a desire to follow his direction and example for the achievement of purposes considered desirable for those who represent the best of the conscience and the consciousness of humanity. How completely subjective this goal is. And what's the goal? It's also the standard. And others whom I could quote will tell you this as well as Ulick does. Looking then at the total picture presented in the book from which I quote Vital Issues in Education Today, there are two things for which we must thank God. First of all, we must thank God for the public schools, for what they have done for this our land. We are told that the chief purpose of the public schools must be the training of character. Well, when you go out in the downtown streets today, you wish there were some people with character, do you not? That had at least the graces, common grace enough to be decent and not to rob and not to rape and not to destroy property and life. So we must be thankful to God that through this means, as well as other means, God has restrained the wrath of man, and we should not be holier in the holier than thou attitude as we seek to build our schools on the foundation of the Christian religion. But then when we have done this, then we must also, and this is our task surely today, engage in dialogue with those such as Dr. Ulick and Castle and others who represent the leadership in public education today. We must ask them this question: how can you explain learning by experience, as Plato asked the question? How can you begin to find a pupil, a self-conscious pupil? Where did it come from? Did it spring forth by chance from a world of pure contingency, in which there is no order, in which there is no creation, in which there is no providence? Does chance produce intelligent human beings? No one has yet seen fit to even offer an attempt to explain how the pupil, an intelligent pupil, can come into existence. And now suppose that you did have, by chance, such an intelligent pupil. Where would you get a teacher to teach such a pupil? Well, he must be a grown-up pupil, must he not, to teach? And where would you get a scientist to tell the teachers what to teach the pupils? The scientists themselves must spring forth from chance, as the teachers must, the pupils must. The world is the world of chance. Man is autonomous, we are told. He's free, that is. He is the source and the reference of all speech that he makes about himself and about the world. God does not exist. God cannot exist. There are no absolutes. There can be no absolutes. That's the theme song of the current philosophy of education, as it is of all the major schools of philosophy in general today. Well, it is with such people that we must speak, but we must not act as though we know it all. We have not, any more than Noah, been wiser in our generation than our day. But we have received grace in the sight of God. And when Noah had received grace in the sight of God, then he became a preacher of righteousness and a practitioner of righteousness. He challenged those of the new morality of the day, the permissive morality. He said, in consequence of this absolute breaking of the laws of God, the moral laws of God, you will be destroyed. Well, how does anybody know today that what the Bible says about the coming of the judgment day because of the wickedness and the corruption of mankind is not true? What man is there that can honestly tell you that he is omniscient and knows the future? He says so, in effect. He says what you say is there can't be there. Nobody knows. Then he turns right around and he says, but I know that what you say is there isn't there. Suppose there's a closet here, and you tell me what you say is in that closet. Nobody knows what's in that closet. But I know that what you say is in there isn't in there. Well, then you might as well not bother about saying what I say is in there is in there. That's the same thing. Well, now that's all of modern philosophy, modern psychology, and modern philosophy of education. They all say that nobody knows. There cannot have been in history, as the Pharisees said to Jesus, that he blasphemed. So they today say that Jesus blasphemes if he claims to be absolute, if he claims to be one with God, if he says that his word is that which counts. Then they say, you blaspheme. Well, then we can ask them in turn, will you then kindly tell us how you make this philosophy of education intelligible to yourself? How do you explain human experience in its origin, in its goal, in its standards? And then there is no answer. We have now reached the stage of human culture in which unbelieving culture has nothing left to say. We do not rejoice in this. We grieve over it. Jesus wept over Jerusalem because, as the people of God, they failed to fulfill the mandate God had given them. They were untrue to the principles of the theocracy instituted by God himself, that through them the nations of the world should be blessed. And so they were rejected. But Jesus weeps over them. How oft would I have brought thy children into my protecting as a hen gathers her chicks? But they would not. So we must weep over the world, over those who would educate their children without a goal, without a standard, and without motivation. No, not without a goal, without a standard, without a motivation, but with a goal and a standard and a motivation against the Christ. He that is not for me, says Jesus, is against me. You can't be neutral in the field of education any more than you can be neutral anywhere else. Some few weeks ago, in one of the magazines, I think it was Life, there was a picture. It was the time of General Eisenhower's death, when there was a picture of General Eisenhower and a group of soldiers surrounding him, looking into his eyes. It was the night before they were to be sent across the channel to the beaches of Normandy to die, many of them. And I had in his pocket a statement to the effect that if the invasion failed, he alone should be held responsible for the failure. But the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, whom we serve in education, has got no such thing in his pocket. He has not failed. He cannot fail. He has already won. Satan has already been defeated on the cross. And we want our children to go forth into life with a consciousness of this fact, that our Christ has won and that he has saved human culture and that we have had some little thing to do with it. That's why we want our Christian schools today. Let us pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank thee for our Christian schools, for our Christian culture. We pray thee wilt thou forgive us, because we are tongue-tied and we have failed to speak forth thy name to the sons of men. We have refused to eat pulse. We have been ashamed of doing so. We have sought the culture of this world and the honor of men. Forgive us, we beseech thee, and teach us to weep over those that are lost, those that have a false philosophy of education and of culture, those who would train their children according to a wrong goal, a mistaken standard, and without faith, against the Christ instead of for the Christ. Forgive us, we beseech thee, and bless us now as we humbly seek with the pardon of thy sins upon us to do thy will in serving thee in the realm of culture as well as in the realm of religion. For Jesus, our Savior's sake. Amen.